This is a $90 Ethernet cable. Part of the price is because it's about 10 meters, longer than normal, and also it's Category 8. Yes, I know this is overkill, but I wanted to kind of go all out when replacing a cable that apparently has been causing me problems for the past several years on my computer, and I didn't want to have to go through that again. So what I'll talk about is the problem that I was having before, what caused it, as well as why I decided to go with this absolutely overkill cable. Yes, I know it's overkill, but I do have some reasons for it for the Cat8 cable, so we'll go over all that. And there are some things about this cable that are definitely notable and interesting that you probably want to stick around for. So really quick, the problem I was having for the past couple years is my computer would have really random disconnects on the internet. It would work for 90% of the day, and then randomly, once or twice a day maybe, it would just disconnect for a few seconds, come back on. Sometimes this was really at bad timing during a video conference or something like that, and I was never able to figure out what the problem was until one day I decided to take out my cable tester and test the actual wire going from my wall to my computer. And sure enough, it had a split pair error. And you're probably asking, why didn't you try replacing the cable or testing it in the past 2 years? And basically, I'm an idiot, that's why. But it's not quite that simple, so let me explain what a split pair wiring error is and why it's a little bit more difficult to detect than other wiring errors, because it actually does allow the data to go through. So it'll work most of the time. It'll appear like it's a no problem cable, and then every once in a while, something will come along and cause it to basically break the connection. Hi, future me here, have to jump in because as I was recording the footage for this video, I could not get the cable tester to produce the split pair error again. I took the cable out from behind the desk and where it was running before, and it wouldn't produce the error anymore. So I believe now the reason for the split pair was probably a false positive, and I'm now thinking it's likely that it actually was just radio interference, which would cause split pair-like problems. And specifically, this interference would come from other cables it was running next to before, but is not anymore, and also could be because of a cell tower that I'll talk about later, but is very close to where I live, so that could be very much a cause. And I actually took the shielding off of the end of the cable I was using, as it was coiled up and not producing the error anymore, and then it started producing it again, which would mean that potentially that shielding was not there. Now the interference was getting in again and it started producing the split pair error. So just keep that in mind for the rest of the video. It's very possible that in fact it was just radio interference the whole time, which still justifies getting the Cat8 cable for the improved shielding. Inside an Ethernet cable, you have four pairs, twisted pairs, of data wires. And the reason these are twisted together is that so you can basically use it to cancel out a lot of noise. They do this for XLR balanced audio cables. So balancing is what this is called. And in super simple terms, the idea behind this is that any interference coming in, because the wires are so closely bound, the interference noise is going to be applied to those cables equally. And if you have one signal that is one polarity and the other is the other, you could basically subtract one from the other and only get the signal out, and it will have the noise cancel each other out. But don't worry if that doesn't really make sense. You just have to know that because you twist them together, it makes it a lot easier to cancel out any external interference. But it also helps eliminate what is called crosstalk, where two cables running next to each other actually interfere with each other, because when electricity goes through any wire, it induces a magnetic field, and magnetic fields can then induce an electrical current in another cable. So they basically are inserting extra noise and signal into each other. And it turns out that if you actually twist these pairs together very closely, it not only cancels out the interference from external sources, but also from each other. But again, it still has to be where the same signal is sent on both cables, just inverted for that to work. Now, in a split pair, basically one of these pairs on the end is mixed up with another. So yes, the cable from each end is equal. So you send a signal through one end on, say, pin 2, it'll still end up on pin 2 on the other end. So this means that the data still gets through on either side. The computer and the Ethernet cable still sends and receives it as it's expecting. However, internally what happened is the pairs are not paired correctly. So you lose the noise canceling ability on both of those pairs. Now, the shielding around the whole cable might help with canceling out and blocking external interference, but that is not going to help with the crosstalk. In fact, it might make the crosstalk worse, because if the cable is expecting to send the same signal and use those to cancel out the noise, it's going to be subtracting a good signal from another good signal. It might just make things way worse. And that's speculation on my part, but I'm assuming. So this basically explains why I was having such intermittent problems, where 90% of the time it would work, and then every once in a while it would just break the connection and not work and keep connecting and disconnecting, probably because there was some kind of external interference or the crosstalk got bad for some reason. And actually, I think I know what might be a cause of it, which is that there was a cell tower that basically was constructed, I don't know when, but practically across the street from me, and it has been messing with my audio recording. I got a new microphone that requires a lot of amplification, the Shure SM7B, and when I was doing that, I realized that because I had to amplify it so much, there was a small interference signal that was also being amplified that I didn't notice before, and after a bunch of testing, realized it was because of a cell tower. So I was able to eventually get rid of that by using a bunch of ferrite cores. I put like 7 of them on the audio cable, which I'm not going to get into, but it basically makes it harder for the thing to interfere. Anyway, this might explain why I don't remember having issues for a little while after I got the cable, and then at some point in the past several years, this tower went up, because it wasn't there when I moved in, I remember that, and then it must have started interfering, and then that's when it started. So I think from now on, I'm definitely going to be at least testing the cables I buy, every single one, to make sure this doesn't happen again. And these cable testers are not really expensive. I think you can get them for like less than $20 these days. And I figured also to make sure this doesn't happen again is to not take any chances and just get the absolute best overkill cable I was able to find. And the latest and greatest category spec for Ethernet is Cat8. And it's, from my understanding, mostly designed for data centers. So I would kind of consider this industrial, you might think of it as. It's not really meant for homes and stuff. It can handle up to 40 gigabits per second, 2000 megahertz, where I believe 6A is 500 megahertz, and 10 gigabits per second is what the rated speed is, but it could go a little bit higher. And also Cat8 apparently has higher standard for shielding, so I figured that would help too with the interference from that tower. So obviously, having thought I bought a high quality cable from a reputable manufacturer, I was kind of sketched out that it had a wiring error. So I was thinking maybe I'll just make my own cable, but then I actually stumbled upon a listing on Amazon for one company that said they actually tested individually all their cables that they sell with a Fluke cable analyzer thing. It's like a $10,000 Fluke cable certifier, and I thought that was really cool, because every manufacturer says they test their cables, but it's like, do they really? This company, LinkUp, actually does, because they give you a report, and the number of the cable is added as like a label, and then they give you the actual report for that individual cable. So I was definitely more willing to pay a little bit of a premium for that assurance. And no, by the way, this video is not sponsored. I just bought the cable myself. Although if you want to check out this one, I'll put the link in the description. Now, like I mentioned, the price tag on this cable was $90. However, they're not all that expensive. One reason for the higher price on this one is the length. It's 33 feet. 10 meters, so longer than average. That's going to increase the price right off the bat. Also, they had two options for a thickness. They had the stranded wire 26 gauge, and that's thinner, and they also had the 22 gauge solid copper wire, which is thicker, and that's the one I went with. So the 26 gauge one is actually like under half the price, so you don't have to get the solid one. And actually, the solid cable is not ideal in some situations where you have to maybe bend it or have it flexible. The stranded wire is definitely going to be more flexible, but for mine, it doesn't have to be flexible. It's just going to stay in one spot. So the extra thickness of the wire definitely contributed largely to the price. And then also the certification testing, I'm assuming they kind of build that in, or maybe they're just offering it as a value add. But for me personally, this was a huge reason why I bought them in particular. Now, a few notes I wanted to mention talking about the actual cable itself, looking a little bit closer. The first thing I thought was really cool are these connectors. These are apparently a newer type of connector. I think I've seen them being called double shielded. I think a lot of them are mostly for Cat8 cables. I don't know if it's part of the new standard or what, but it looks extremely industrial and durable to me. It's full metal. It even has these little covers on here that attach just like a port would, so you have to press down to take the little caps off. So these are clearly high quality, expensive connectors, and I don't know, maybe I'll buy some of these myself so the next time I want to make some cables. And to be clear, these aren't exclusive connectors to this LinkUp company. I have seen these sold by other companies individually, but it is basically the only cable I've seen that you can buy off the shelf that has these connectors, though I haven't really been looking for Cat8 cables too long. And also, in general, this cable is extremely thick with two C's. I mean, if you compare it to my old cable, it's ridiculously thicker, so part of that is gonna be the cable itself, the copper wiring, I mean, and the rest of it is probably just all extra shielding. Like I mentioned, it is not quite as flexible, actually not nearly as flexible as other Ethernet cables I have, but that is to be expected just by the sheer thickness and the fact that it is solid, and I don't want to mess with it too much, because if you do bend a solid wire too much, it has the potential to break in there, whereas stranded is much less likely to do that. And if you're wondering, no, this is not gonna like make your internet any faster. If you're already getting the maximum speed rated for your internet connection, this is not gonna do it, or unless you're using like 10 gig or something, which I actually do use for my computer and one of my switches, I figured this might be worth it. Other than that though, not really too much more to say about this. It's just an overkill cable, and I wanted to talk about Cat8, this cable in particular, and maybe show the problem that I was having, so if any of you encounter something similar, now you'll know to maybe try to change the cable out. So if you have any thoughts, definitely let me know down in the comments, and if you want to subscribe, also be sure to click the bell next to the subscribe button so you get notifications. I make videos about twice a week. You don't want those getting lost in the rest of your video subscriptions. If you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is one where I was talking about some YouTube scams that you might not have seen or may have seen some of them. So I definitely recommend watching that. I'll just put that link right there. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next one.